Hey, what's going on, guys? We're in the middle of a session right now. I'm training with Ramon and Chris. I'll introduce them to you just in a bit. We're gonna pop into this, and then we're also gonna sit down with Ramon and talk to him about his career. And yeah, it should be good. He's had a really good career. Sit down with him and just let him talk.
One piece of advice, if you could go back to like yourself at 16, 15 years old, you know, as a teenager in high school, what would you go back to Ramon and what would you tell him?
Dang. That's a good one, man. I can fly.
Okay, so this is Ramon. Me and Ramon, when did we meet? Like when you were 17, I was 18 or something?
Probably.
Back then, like our freshman year at UC Davis.
Yeah.
Ramon's going on to play pro. I'll just let you take it from college, UC Davis, the beginning of UC Davis, or wherever you want to take it, and then just go through your career up until now.
For sure. Well, it started the University of California, Davis, obviously. 2011, we got to Davis, met all the boys. Matt Sheldon was there, Matthew Wiesenfarth, my best friend, Christopher Schultz became my roommate, great guy. We sort of created a bond, I'd say, from the beginning, right then and there. We all had similar goals, and we all came from very different backgrounds, all of us not knowing how to get to the end goal, which was to become a professional footballer. I think as we got older and more mature, we started understanding what true sacrifice meant. We started understanding, you know, the small things that is sacrificing being the big man on campus, being Joe Cool, to then becoming the harder stuff, which is your diet, which is your sleep, the weightlifting, the trainings, the extra trainings that we did, the film. Oh my gosh, the film.
Yeah.
And then stopping and watching games, not watching them as fans anymore, but watching them as students.
Yeah.
Later, as we found out, it's just performing at college soccer isn't going to be it for you. You got to perform in other areas. You have to keep in mind that the rest of the world is playing soccer 11 months out of 12. And we are doing it Division I, 3-4 months, if we're lucky. Shelly and I, Christopher Schultz, we all realized that, and we started getting after it. We understood that we had to go find another team, and the closest thing to us was PDL. So from there, I was the first one to venture out. I got a trial with the San Jose Earthquakes U23 at the time. They later became the Burlingame Dragons. You know, the boss man liked me there, Dana Taylor. I think he's a mentor of mine. He's a mentor of mine. He helped me to get into the professional ranks. He brought me in. Later, Matt Sheldon and Wiesenfarth followed. Chris followed as well. But even in there, it was a whole new atmosphere, because then we had players from other colleges competing for the same spot. There were maybe six other center backs competing for two spots. There were, at the time, six other strikers, and then you were later moved to an outside back. There was seven other outside backs competing for one spot. And that was a real taste of competing for a position and making yourself better.
Yeah.
Because if you don't have competition, if you're not in the zone, if you're not in the fight daily, you're not improving. I got pulled into play against the U.S. national team before they left to Brazil. And that's where Tab Ramos saw me and called me up to the U23 national team. I went and had my first cap in the Bahamas. We won the game 5-1, and I got an assist, which I'm very thankful for.
Yeah.
The hard work didn't stop there, right? You keep grinding, because you want to get better. I was later pulled up to the first team with the Earthquakes. That was a real taste of the professional ranks, but I only got 2 to 3 weeks of it. So I didn't get the real taste of competition for games. I was just thankful to be there. So I didn't get to learn much of the professional environment. I got to learn a lot of the professional intensity, I would say. I brought that back to college into my senior year. I received a ton of accolades. I think at one point I was ranked number 4 in top seniors to go on to the next level. And the biggest part there is keeping your feet on the ground, not letting your head get in the clouds, which I thought I did. I thought I did an okay job at it, but it's always going to be tempting. It's always going to be there, and there's always going to be a little sense of you that might let you get carried away.
And like I was living with you during that time, and I didn't notice. It was excitement, you know. I think it was more excitement than having your head like go too big, you know.
Yeah, I totally agree.
Because I do think you have such a, you know, you hear so many things about you, and you're seeing, you know, number 4 in college, and it appears from the outside a lot of people think that like, oh, his head's big. But it's just like you're excited for the opportunities to come. That's what I really thought from what I saw living with you, you know, at the time.
100%. I like the way you put that together, and I totally agree with it. So as we went on forward, I started making my connections. A huge thing is building a network wherever you are, and I started doing that within the Earthquakes. I had a coach, Dana Taylor, my head coach, presented me a whole new world, which was Costa Rican football at the time. I went to the combine. I didn't do so well. I had strep throat at the time. I don't like using that because some people will be like, that's an excuse, you were sick, da da da. So whatever, I try not to make that such a big deal. I'll just put it on myself and said, I didn't perform. And in the professional world, if you don't perform when it's important, you're gone. Mm-hmm. It's that cutthroat. I ended up losing my senior contract, which would have been like a 4-year deal. It was maybe a year and then option after option after option with all raises. It was a very amazing contract. But beforehand, I had already made a plan B. I accepted a trial with Deportivo Saprissa. I flew over to Costa Rica 1 week of a trial, and they offered me a contract. I politely said no. So it wasn't necessarily that I closed the door there. I sort of kept it shut. I said, let's stay open for negotiations. And when the MLS fell through, I went over to Saprissa. Mm-hmm. In Saprissa, I got my real test of real taste of professional football. And I'd say it was even more cutthroat because it was in an area like Central America. I'm a Mexican-American. I was born in Mexico, but at a young age, moved over to the United States. So I see myself as an American more than I am Mexican. I'm an American that can speak Spanish pretty well. But being over there, I got thrown into a Latino culture, a Latino way of life, which is soccer over everything. And I got my real taste of it.
Yeah.
I got my real taste of how people can love you in 30 seconds if you score a game winner like I did against León. Or people can hate you because you got hurt and you were out for 5 months, and people telling you that the shirt didn't fit. Yeah, the shirt fit too big on you, is what they said. And there I had my first test of mental strength. And I won't lie to you, I failed. I cracked because it was new to it. I'd never thought it would be so cutthroat, so heavy on me. And I was pushed to the limit. I wanted to quit. I was down in the dumps. I was very sad. Until one day it sort of clicked. My father told me, one day I told him, Dad, I'm thinking about letting it go. And my dad turned to me and said, quitters get nowhere. And you quit once, you'll quit forever. You'll find the easy way out. And if you want it, it's going to be hard. But at the end of the day, it's going to be worth it. Mm-hmm. But how bad do you want it? I know it sounds cliche like those YouTube videos, but it's true.
Yeah.
How bad do you want to suffer to get it? And that's when I made the decision. I go, you know what? I'm not done. I'm not done suffering for my dream. And I started working hard in training sessions, started getting a couple friendly games here and there. And sure enough, some scouts saw me from an NASL team, Puerto Rico FC, and they took me over on loan. And then from there, I had a good season. I played outside back. I told them, you can maneuver me wherever.
Yeah.
I got fit to be an outside back. I'm a center back, and I'll be a center back till the day I die. But if you need to move me there, coach, I'll do it for you, you know? I was moved back into center back in Puerto Rico. I did well. I was resilient when the time came to be resilient, and then the rest is history. I got a contract to Ottawa, then from Ottawa, Fresno. In Ottawa, I thought I had a very successful season. Fresno, I had another successful season. They picked up my option again, and I'm there for another year. In Ottawa, they also wanted to pick up my option, but I was stubborn, and I wanted a bigger pay raise. So I fought for it, and I said, you know what? I'm leaving. I'll go find another. And you know, God is good. I came back to my home state, California. My family is 5 hours away from me. And I love Fresno. The fans there, to me, are family. Mm-hmm. I love them.
Back in Costa Rica, you said that you cracked. And I think that there is a big misconception about, like, when you go over and chase the dream. And you like what you said, we were talking over there. You're sold a dream, and you think, like, it's going to be one way. But when you're over in a different country by yourself, you know, you don't fit in exactly how you fit in. It's incredibly tough. And, like, I know, like, we talked when you were over there and, like, just how hard that was.
100%.
And, like, I don't want to, like, dissuade people from going over there, but I think that it is really hard. So what was, like, the hardest part of being over there?
The biggest thing was injuries. The injuries, I got a surgery there. I tore my pectoral tendon, which was huge. My first year there, I had 10 starts in the preseason. I was going to lead up to be a starter. And then I got my first real injury. And I would say that was... that started leading into that moment that you described. The combination there was, so when you're in college in the United States, in America, it's very family oriented, and it's fantastic. Your high school friends, you'll always remember them. Your high school team, you'll always remember your club team, you'll always remember them. And to you guys, being at Surf Cup was like a World Cup for you.
Yeah.
You know, it was do or die, like ride or die for your boys.
Yeah.
Over there, there is a family environment, but they're not going to wait for you. If you're falling behind, you're going to fall behind and you're going to stay there. And it gets lonely. It gets lonely, you get neglected. And the truth is there, you have to man up.
Yeah.
You have to man up and you have to find a way to catch, get right back with the pack and then try to beat the pack again. When you're competing, it's different. It's motivational, but if you're holding the boys back, they're gonna let you know you're holding them back. And yeah, it's not gonna be fun when they tell you.
Yeah.
But it's necessary. It's necessary. You can't sugarcoat it because that's just gonna hurt the team. And I played for the biggest team in Central America, Deportivo Saprissa. I said it was the Barcelona of Central America.
Yeah.
So I got the full wrath of these World Cup players, of these big time players playing in Europe, coming back, having amazing MLS careers, coming back, maybe finishing or starting their career there. So I would say that was also new to me, being as, well, I thought you were my brother, but okay, now you're just leaving me here. But the truth is, in the professional ranks, you've got to pull your weight. And if you don't pull your weight, you're going to get cut. The GM's not going to like you. The head coach's not going to like you. You're going to eventually fall behind.
It's a business. It turns into a job, a business. It's no longer, it is a team, but it's first a business.
There's so many more factors now.
Yeah, yeah.
Right? Mm-hmm. Club soccer, you lose a game, no one's going to lose a job.
Yeah.
You know, the head coach will probably be there the next day. I was in there and I saw the most winning coach of Saprissa get fired after we got knocked out of the CONCACAF Champions League. It's cutthroat. And I think all those moments led up to that moment where I decided to feel sorry for myself. Whereas I should have responded and say, the hell with that, excuse my French. I'm gonna go for it even harder.
Yeah.
I need to catch up to the pack and I need to beat them in there. And so that was the moment. But later, I thank God for it, I thank my father for it. That's why if you surround yourself with amazing individuals, amazing mentors, amazing coaches, friends, brothers, family that are real with you, they're going to sit you down and they're going to be like, buddy, you can do better than this. That's not the Ramon I know. That's not the Matt Sheldon I know.
Mm-hmm.
And that's going to spark a fire again and you're going to get right back in the hunt.
What do you think was the best part of like this whole of being a pro, like from the last 5 years of you doing this, like what's been the best, the most rewarding moment?
I mean, there is nothing like going out in the starting 11 in a stadium and the national anthem. That's big in the United States. In some, there's no, but that starting 11 picture.
Yeah.
Right there. That moment that, so you get all the jitters and the nerves and the warm up and everything. And the moment you're in your position and the referee checks with everyone and blows the whistle, there cannot be a more rewarding feeling of hearing that whistle and it's game on.
Yeah.
And let's get after it. You're doing what you love. You're doing what you chased year after year after year. When I was 8 years old and when I put the goal down that I wanted to become a professional footballer. And there is nothing like that whistle. Obviously, there's other rewarding factors, but for me, that is such a big part of being a pro.
Yeah.
There's winning a soccer game, which is everything. I get on my knees. I thank the Lord for it. But there's nothing like when you're in your position after the warm's done, the national anthem, the starting 11 picture, and that whistle when the referee checks with everyone. Let's get this. That is unreal.
I like that. What do you think has been a huge factor as to why you got to the pro? I mean, if you had to go, obviously there's mentality and there's training and everything, but if someone asks you, Ramon, why did you make it to the pro level versus these guys, these center backs who fizzled out at the college level or the semi-pro level or whatever?
I surrounded myself with amazing people. I surrounded myself with amazing people. Chris Schultz, you know him. Unreal man. Unreal man. And that guy pushed me to the limit. You. Senior year, junior year. You pushed me to the limit. We had fights and
we did have fights.
When we lived together. You know, I was like, Shelly, get in my room and let's talk it out. Yeah. We're in the field, we almost kill each other.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's okay.
But it's because we were passionate. We were passionate about doing something, and when you get into competition, it's
and it was things like, you know, I would yell at you for, you know, maybe, I'm trying to remember, maybe doing a drill a little simpler, and then you would get on me for scoring headers.
Yeah.
But because I scored headers, because I got some results, because I can put the ball, I put the ball in the net twice with Ottawa Fury, mm-hmm. I'm an offensive presence. I've contributed to the team.
Yeah.
You, because you played simpler, you're now a more maneuverable player. You can play striker, you can play winger, you can play outside back. You understand the roles, you understand where you can be creative and where you can be a simple footballer. Mm. And those moments led to us learning. Secondly, my individual discipline was, I believe, on another level.
Yeah.
And you can ask Matt how I was in school. I mean, did I go out and parties?
No. Like, I'll actually talk about this. Like, even my freshman, sophomore year, I wasn't as disciplined. You know, freshman, sophomore year of college, I wasn't as disciplined. I kind of went in there being like, I want the college experience. You know, I want to enjoy stuff. I didn't want to sacrifice. And then once I saw that, you know, I was getting success, and then I saw that this could be possible and I could see the pros, then it kind of like, it flipped a switch. And I think living
stars aligned, huh?
Yeah, so it was stars aligned. And living with you and living with Chris and seeing, like, you know, how seriously it can be taken, it helped push me to the next level. And I think that you were, from the very beginning, completely disciplined with that, more disciplined than I was. And then I think that, and it's crazy too, because you didn't have early success with Davis.
No.
You were on the bench, and like, you fought, and you trained, and you worked and worked to get to the starting lineup.
That's right.
And so I think that, like, that was something I always, like, honestly really admired you for, was not having the initial success, staying disciplined, staying working at it, and then completely turning it completely around. But by your senior year, you're one of the best players in the nation in terms of, like, in seniors getting recruited for the MLS.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right. So I thought discipline was everything, and diving into the discipline, the things that I did, it's a little interesting. People can make fun of me because of it. It might sound a little girly, but I started writing journals. Whenever you're down in the dumps, whenever you had a bad session, you dive in and you just remind yourself, these were great moments in my career. These are the things I did to achieve them. This is how I got there. And those journals are a little reminder, a little motivation to click back into it. And then I set, in those journals, I had my goals. And I had the ladder, the blueprint of getting towards that goal. I said, okay, what am I going to do? I'm going to be defensive player of the week at least once this year. What am I going to do? I'm at least going to score one or two goals this year. How many shutouts am I going to get as a defender? I want to get 7 shutouts this year. How many clearances do I want to make? I want to make the triple digits, et cetera, bomb, bomb, bomb. And I had a game plan on how to get, this is how I'm going to become a professional footballer. It's the only way I knew. And I said, because I didn't have that edge of how to get there properly, I just put maximum effort in any category I knew existed and how to get there, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
I dove into it with my dieting. I remember this guy had an unreal diet, and I'd be super mad on how he had a six-pack, and I was like, I'm going to find a way. He'd make fun of me because I'd eat Lucky Charms.
Yeah.
Lucky Charms or Captain Crunch.
At night.
At night, yeah.
And I remember you came up to me like, yo, Shelly, I remember the switch that you decided that you want to take it healthy. You're like, why is Lucky Charms bad for me? Why is Captain Crunch not good? Why is the McMuffin from McDonald's worse than the Egg McMuffin I make at home? And I was like, Ramon, let's get it. And it's like, we all brought something to the table, you know?
100%.
You brought the discipline, and I was brought like the diet, and somebody else brought something, and it all combined. I always say that house was the reason why, if I didn't live there, I wouldn't have been a pro.
100%. And it's one of the things that goes back, when you surround yourself with great individuals, you're going to learn from them. Because if I told you right here I knew it all, that's a damn lie.
Yeah.
That's a damn lie. Because my diet, I didn't know how to diet. Yeah. I come from a Mexican family where, you know, if there's carne asada on the table right there, it's like, you're eating healthy, you know?
Yeah.
There's chips and salsa, that's healthy. You know, salsa, you know? Or,
it's tomatoes.
Exactly. Exactly. So when you surround yourself with a good group of people, they bring new things to the table. Whereas you bring what you have to the table, and you can now pick and choose from their minds and acquire that into your new routine. Mm-hmm. So I say that my discipline was unreal. The people I surrounded myself were amazing, from grown adults to college students. And then my journals and my goals and how to get there, the blueprint of how to get there. That's what I believe led to the success. That's what helped me make so much noise to force scouts to look my way and say, he's not that bad, he can do it.
And then last question, one piece of advice, if you could go back to like yourself at 16, 15 years old, you know, as a teenager in high school, what would you go back to Ramon and what would you tell him?
Dang, that's a good one, man.
Uh-huh.
Is this mariachi band, Ramon?
Mariachi band, Ramon. Yeah, I played in a mariachi band for 4 years.
I tell him to keep following that.
Yeah.
Oh, keep chasing that dream.
What would I tell that kid? That kid's an animal. That kid had a mullet in high school, man. I would tell that kid that it's tougher than you think. It's tougher than you think. And you should throw focus on the mental side of it. Because there's going to be some pretty big crash and burns in your career. Pretty big ones. You're gonna faceplant 1 million times in your career. Mm-hmm. And when you faceplant really hard like I did in Costa Rica, like I did after the combine, after the MLS, I want to tell that Ramoncito, don't worry about it. Mm-hmm. Don't worry about it. Keep pushing. Keep working. Don't let it faze you. Don't let it faze you. Because maybe with that advice, it still would have hurt.
Yeah.
But the response might have been different. Oh, yeah. That moment that led to that crack, that moment that we described, it would have been very painful. Mm-hmm. But maybe the response would have been different.
Yeah.
Maybe the answer that Ramon with that advice would have given is different. So anytime I can share advice, there's a former teammate of mine on his way to the draft too in combine. We chat up the phone and I tell him my errors and I say, be careful, still be yourself, because that's what you're marketing, that's what you're selling. Mm-hmm. But be careful in these areas.
Yeah.
So that's the advice I would tell.
I like it.
16-year-old Ramoncito.
Yeah.
In the really mariachi like band with the mullet. driving a beat up minivan.
And I always say that. Yeah, I literally always say, like, my career has been a roller coaster of emotions. It's been low lows.
For sure.
And amazing highs.
For sure.
And it's to not get that low on the lows and don't get too high on the highs.
Amen.
And you ride out right in the middle.
Amen to that.
All right,
amen.
Cool. Well, Ramon, thank you for just taking the time to talk. I really appreciate it. I'd love to, like, sit down and do more, because, like, it's like, how many times in college did we sit down, like, in your room, and you, me, Chris, and Weezy, whoever was there, would just, like, talk about, like, this kind of stuff?
I mean, hours, daily, weekly.
Yeah.
If we didn't have a conversation, something was wrong. We might have gotten in a fight.
We probably took a week off of a fight. But that was Ramon Martín del Campo. All the stuff's going to be in the description, social media, at school, right?
Like, yeah, absolutely, absolutely.
In the description, go follow him. Great career, great mentality, and just a great friend, too.
Thanks, bro.
Yeah, no problem, puto.
Great style, too.
Awesome.
That was fun, dude. That was fun.
So this is Chris Borden, right? Mm-hmm. Chris Borden. And you've been watching my videos for, how long have you been watching for?
About a year.
And do you want to say anything, like, now you're on the channel or anything?
Yeah, ever since I started watching your videos, just went out and trained every day, saw a massive improvement over the past year.
That's really cool. And so you're going to play at Cal State LA next season?
Yes.
That's going to be awesome. So I wish you all the best, man. Good session today, and then we'll stay in contact and see what happens.
Thank you.
All right.